Good afternoon, good morning, good evening to all of you who are joining us from various corners of the globe, and welcome to this discussion on empowering local solutions through climate finance. My name is Louise Brown. I am the director of Triple Capital, an institution in Namibia that aims to align finance with sustainable and inclusive development. Today's discussion is part of the Caux Dialogue on Environment and Security, as well as the Summer Academy on Climate, Land and Security, and is co-organized by the Initiatives of Change Switzerland, the Geneva Center for Security Policy, and Triple Capital, and is sponsored by the Africa Climate Change Fund at the African Development Bank. This year's dialogue is significant as the Initiatives of Change Switzerland is celebrating 75 years of inspiring, equipping, and connecting change makers. Initiatives of Change Switzerland recognizes that human change is at the heart of the response required to address the environmental crisis we are facing, and that working together is imperative and requires trust, stakeholder engagement, and sharing of data and practice for the common good. If you would like to get in touch with Initiatives of Change, you can contact the co-director, Nick Foster. I will be putting his email address in the chat. Without further ado, I would like to introduce my esteemed panel for today's discussion. Professor Saleemul is the director of the International Center for Climate Change and Development in Bangladesh, and professor at the Independent University of Bangladesh, as well as an associate of the International Institute for Environment and Development, and a senior advisor on locally led adaptation with the Global Center on Adaptation, among many other prestigious roles and achievements, which would take up this whole webinar if I was to list them all. He is a widely published author and expert on climate change adaptation. Ms. Teddy MUGABO is the Chief Executive Officer of the Rwanda Green Fund, also known as FONERWA for its French acronym, and she was previously the Head of Business Development at the same institution, where she coordinated efforts to mobilize resources towards Rwanda's green growth ambitions. And I would note that the Rwanda Green Fund has to date raised over $200 million for climate action in Rwanda. Mr. David Jackson is the Director of Local Development Finance at the United Nations Capital Development Fund. He has over 30 years of experience in implementing and financing local development, including in the UK for the London government, in Mozambique with the UNCCD, and in Indonesia as an advisor to the government and UNDP. He designed the Local Climate Adaptive Living Facility, LOCAL, a global mechanism that enables local governments in least developed countries to access climate finance for building resilience. And we'll be learning more about this mechanism during the course of today's discussion. I have the immense privilege of moderating this discussion on the topic of empowering local solutions through climate finance. Over the past few days, other discussions in this series of dialogues that we've been having as part of the Caux Dialogue on Environment and Security and the Summer Academy, we have repeatedly heard speakers emphasize the fact that communities and actors at the local level who are on the front lines of confronting the climate change crisis and interlinked challenges of land degradation and conflict over natural resources are also incredibly resourceful, innovative, entrepreneurial, and well-positioned to come up with solutions to the challenges they face. However, they are often viewed as voiceless beneficiaries and left out of the decisions around what interventions get funded and how. In addition, less than 10% of climate finance reaches the local level. And there is a gap between the needs and solutions at the local level and international climate finance, which often doesn't reach them. I would like to start off by giving the floor to Professor Saleem. You have played a key role in developing the principles of locally led adaptation, which attempt to change this scenario and put local people at the forefront of driving development. These principles have recently been adopted by over 40 governments and institutions. So I think I'd like to ask you if you could kick us off by telling us some more about these principles and why they are so crucial. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Louise, and thank you for inviting me to this very interesting discussion. So you quite rightly pointed out that I have been working personally on what we now call locally led adaptation to climate change. Previously, it had a previous incarnation as community-based adaptation, which has now changed into locally led, which is a broader term beyond just the community itself, including local government, for example. And over the last year and a half, as part of the Global Commission on Adaptation action track on locally led adaptation, a number of the commissioners in the adaptation action, Global Coalition, as well as a number of organizations from UN agencies to funding agencies like the Green Climate Fund and the Adaptation Fund, to international NGOs like IIED and others, WRI, have collectively came together with these eight different principles of how to ensure that local adaptation is genuinely supporting the most vulnerable communities themselves. And amongst the principles, I won't go through all eight of them, amongst the principles was firstly recognizing that local communities and people have agency. They are not to be treated as simply targets or beneficiaries even of top-down efforts that are supposedly meant for their benefit, but don't really involve them either in the design or in the implementation. And so ensuring that their voices play a role in both the design of any kind of intervention as well as the implementation of that intervention. The second is to do with resource flow, funding. At the moment, the global funds that are going from the developed countries globally to the developing countries, as you know, there's $100 billion a year supposed to be delivered. It hasn't been delivered, and there's a lot of discussion going on about that at the moment. But even amongst, however much has been delivered, and the claims are in the order of $80 billion, although that's a disputed number, only 20% of that is going for adaptation. And that is not right, because the developing countries had asked for at least 50% of the funding to go for adaptation. So there's a big shortfall there. But even more importantly, and more, I would say, ignominiously, of the money that goes for adaptation, only 10% of it actually reaches the most vulnerable. And first of all, it's very difficult to make that judgment because they don't keep information. There's no transparency. But my colleagues in IID did a lot of digging into finding out where the money went, and they could only trace 10% of the money going to the most vulnerable communities. So that's a very abysmal record so far from these big international agencies, both bilateral as well as multilateral. And so we need to recognize that they have failed so far, and they need to do better. And they need to ensure, the third principle is that funding is actually delivered to and tracked and monitored as to who is receiving that funding. Another principle is to allow the local communities themselves to be the, if you like, clients or judges of what is supposed to happen and what is supposed to be delivered, rather than the donors. The donors need to be answerable to the recipients of the funds, not the other way around. If they are not delivering it in a manner that helps people, then people will be the judges to say that they didn't deliver it properly. And so a bottom-up monitoring, if you like, of how funding gets delivered. And the final point to make here is to bring together the actors who are working at the local level. And I would argue that we are now entering this year, 2021, in fact, the second half of 2021, we have just entered the era of what I call loss and damage from climate change. We are seeing it happen on our television screens every day now, with the floods in Germany killing over 100 people, in Belgium, in China, in India, all over the world. We are seeing floods, wildfires, heat waves, killing people and destroying crops and property and infrastructure. This is an all attributable to human-induced climate change. These are no longer natural events. They are all attributable, scientifically attributable, to human-induced climate change. In fact, I'm one of the co-authors of a big multi-authored research paper that's just been published that makes that very point. The extreme events of today are now absolutely scientifically attributable to the fact that global mean temperature has been raised over 1 degree because of the emissions of greenhouse gases. So now the onus is on anybody who says these are not climate change, human-induced climate change, to prove that it's not human-induced climate change, because the presumption is that any major event or unheard of event or unprecedented event is now attributable to human-induced climate change. And so we have entered this era of human-induced climate change. And as a result, another transformation that's taking place is what we used to previously call vulnerable communities, as they are facing the challenges of climate impacts and surviving, if they survive. Obviously, for those who don't survive, it doesn't apply. But once they survive, they actually become resilient. They are learning how to adapt. And in a sense, they are the front line of adaptation. They are the first adapters. And I'm setting up a coalition of what I'm terming local adapters. These people used to be called vulnerable communities. Now that they're facing climate change in reality, they are adapting to the impacts of climate change. They may not know the jargon called adaptation or climate change, but they are doing it in practice. And therefore, they are the ones who know what needs to be done. And we, the outsiders, need to learn from them what needs to be done, because the table has turned. It's not us with the knowledge from our science and our computers and our books that will go and tell them what to do. It's them who know what needs to be done, and we need to learn from them and see how we can help them. So it turns around the table on whose knowledge counts. In my view, their knowledge counts for more than our knowledge now, and we need to accept that and learn from them and change the way that we do our own research, our own evidence gathering, our own monitoring and learning on what is good adaptation to climate change. So to me, it's a profound paradigm shift in how we think about knowledge, how we think about resource flows, how we think about recognition of reality on the ground. And climate change is now a reality on the ground. It's not theory anymore. Maybe I'll stop there. Happy to take questions later on, Louise.
Thank you very much, Saleem, for those insightful words. For those who are listening to this webinar, you are welcome to post your questions in the chat, and we will be getting into a question and answer session with the audience, with the speakers. I think now I would like to turn to Teddy. Rwanda is a country that has really taken leadership on climate change and green growth issues, and on looking at how to develop in a way that builds resilience of communities, of the economy, and of ecosystems. And the Rwanda Green Fund is an institution that is putting some of these principles that Saleem spoke about into action in the work that you do. So Teddy, could you talk to us a little bit about the Rwanda Green Fund, what it is and what it's doing?
Thank you, Louise. First of all, very happy to be participating on this panel. So I'll just briefly take you through a and really building on what Saleem just mentioned, I'm going to really focus on the flow of funds and why having national green funds, I believe, can actually be something that ensures that we have that proper flow and the right people are getting this funding. So next, please. So just very briefly, before I get to the Rwanda Green Fund, I think it's also important to highlight that Rwanda has set a very, we have a green growth and climate resilience strategy, which was developed in 2011. And this is basically a framework which mainstreams climate change across sectors. And from that strategy, there was also a need to have a financing vehicle. Basically, we cannot achieve green growth if we don't have the finance. So that's how FONERWA, the Rwanda Green Fund, came to exist. Next. And so the fund has been in place since 2013. And just to give you a glimpse of who we are a fund whose mandate is to attract climate finance, which we then use to deploy to different institutions. This is both private sector, public sector, and NGOs. Just to give you some numbers, to date, we've been able to mobilize over $200 million in grant funding. And we've supported over 44 projects. And again, to show the impact to date, through our projects, we've been able to create over 158,000 jobs. We've been able to provide access to clean energy to close to 80,000 households. And another key important impact we've had, we've been able to, through our projects, 23,000 hectares of land have been able to have been protected against soil erosion. So I think this again talks very much to what Saleem was saying through these adaptation projects that have been implemented on the ground, particularly in the area of conservation of natural resources. We've seen a big one impact in one ensuring that the most vulnerable populations that are affected by climate change impacts actually have been supported. And so I just wanted to give you these numbers. Next. So again, we, as a fund, we have sector priorities. So we've identified sector priorities. Obviously climate smart agriculture is one big one, considering that 80% of our population is actually into subsistence farming and also highly susceptible to climate change impacts. So we also have renewable energy, biomass replacement, green cities. These are some of the new emerging ones, so which is more leaning towards mitigation, green cities, sustainable transport and waste. Next. I also wanted to just touch on a few of the projects that we've funded, or just to give you an idea of what we've been able to do. One good example is a project that looks at an electronic recycling plant. We've been able to support this project and provided a grant to a tune of $2 million. And now the recycling plant has been able to attract an investor who now runs the park. And through this, a significant amount of green jobs have been created. Next. Another project is one looking at electrifying Rwanda's motor taxis. Again, here we have a company that developed and basically needed some grant funding to support the initial proof of concept electric motor taxi. So we've been able to support this. And as part of this project, it was able to inform our transport policy, whereby electric mobility has been prioritized as a key area of focus going forward. And last but not least, I also wanted to highlight the Green Stick Gully project that is now under implementation, which is really looking at putting in place or establishing an estate that shows what sustainable urbanization could look like, also with an emphasis of affordability. Because again, I want to also go back to what Saleem was saying. We need to make sure that whatever projects we're implementing on the ground actually address the issues, whether it's affordability issues, whether it's vulnerability. So I think at the fund, we always, whenever we're at least providing funding to projects or even in a part of the criteria, there's that so environmental protection, climate change, but also development. We have to ensure that the most vulnerable and are the people that are going to receive all these projects that we're implementing actually going to have an impact on them. So maybe I can stop there, and then maybe I also wanted to highlight next. I think it's also important to highlight that we now have a very ambitious NDC, which obviously there's also there's funds that are going to be focusing on adaptation as well as mitigation, but I think I'll focus on adaptation since that's the conversation we're having today. I think it's really important that, or at least a lesson that we've learned, and having the Rwanda Green Fund in place, I believe this is actually a local solution in itself, and it's proven that by having national climate funds, it provides an opportunity for countries to, one, access climate finance, but also reduce the different levels and we ensure that we attract climate finance that addresses the needs of the country, that supports us to reach our priorities. So I think something I'm really really arguing for, that it's important that countries, different countries, think about having funds or national climate funds, because on our side we've seen a great role. Although I also have to talk about the accessibility of the finance is not always the easiest. These are some of the challenges that I believe developing countries face, the processes the processes can be quite complicated. But I think on another side, I'm also very happy to share that the Rwanda Green Fund has at least been able to access this amount of funding, and this is through both bilaterals and multilaterals, but also the Green Climate Fund in particular. We have a project that we're running that looks at adaptation across sectors to a tune of $32 million of receipts from the Green Climate Fund. So I'll stop there, but I'm very happy to answer any questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Teddy, for that overview of the Rwanda Green Fund, and congratulations, because I think that what you've achieved in these short years with the Rwanda Green Fund is really remarkable, and other countries should look to Rwanda's example. And I would also note that for anyone who's been to Rwanda and visited Kigali, the impacts, the results of some of these projects are very visible. You can see Kigali is one of the cleanest and greenest cities that I've ever visited. So it's, the results are really there to be seen. So I think it's really laudable. I'd like to turn to David to talk to us about some of the innovative work that the UN Capital Development Fund is doing with local governments and actors in Asia and Africa to integrate climate resilience into local development and fiscal transfer systems. David, over to you.
Thank you so much indeed, Louise, and thank you very much for the invitation to speak at this important meeting. And I think building really on what both Saleem and Teddy have said, it's clear that climate change is real, it's here, we know that. It's clear that adaptation is key. It's too late to limit global warming to 1.5 degrees. And it's also clear, as Saleem very eloquently outlined, that the local level is where the knowledge is about what needs to be done. Now, one of the pieces of the jigsaw that is missing is how to get the resources down to the local level and how to empower the institutions at the local level that actually have the mandate and the responsibility and the capacity to address climate adaptation, in particular, mitigation to some extent, but adaptation in particular. And these are, of course, local governments. What LOCAL, the Local Climate Adaptive Living Facility, aims to do is to be a global mechanism, actually born out of the LDCs, the least developed countries, but now spreading to middle-income countries and many other countries, a global mechanism for channeling finance to local governments for climate adaptation. And I'm just going to spend a couple of moments, you know, on why this is important. It doesn't exist right now, but it needs to, at the scale required, but it needs to be scaled up urgently. If one thinks about the mandates of local governments, their responsibilities across the world, whether urban or rural, it's all about land use management. It's all about drainage, storage, and management of water. It's about urban planning. It's about, in rural areas, agricultural extension and agricultural management. It's really about, it's about roads and road maintenance, bridges. It's about the key issues that need to be addressed in order to build resilience and to climate change. And these are the entities that are responsible for this. These are the entities that have the mandate, the capacity to invest in these issues. And these are the entities that throughout history have adapted to climate change. If you travel around the world, you'll see local infrastructure is different in different places because it's an adaptation to climate change. A bridge in the Arctic Circle is a little bit different than a bridge on the equator because the way it's been designed adapts to climate change and what's likely to happen in those climates. Yet these very entities that are responsible and accountable for adaptation to climate change do not get a fair share or even a small share of the resources devoted for climate change adaptation. They are either concentrated in central government entities or in non-governmental entities. And really, you will not achieve a global climate adaptation at the scale required without local governments being a key actor in this, not a beneficiary, not a passive beneficiary, but a key actor, a key agent for driving the adaptation and the resilience. Saleemul Haq was very eloquent in describing that the knowledge is at the local level. It is. It's very important that communities are involved and communities have their say. As key agents, it's also very important that local institutions are accountable to those communities. Sometimes local governments are not 100% accountable, but at the same time, it's extremely important that those local governments have the resources required to drive that adaptation. So that's what LOCAL is designed to do. Now, it works through intergovernmental fiscal transfers, and the aim of LOCAL is to provide an incremental top-up, an incremental increase in the value of the funds that local governments receive from central governments, in order for those local governments to be able to use this money fungibly across all sectors. Because the other advantage, of course, local governments is that it's not limited to one particular sector. They can spend across sectors to retrofit, to co-finance with central government agencies, to co-finance with NGOs, to co-finance with the community, and to invest in climate resilience and adaptation. And because the money comes as a top-up through the existing transfer system, it is a very cheap and effective way of transferring resources. It doesn't require a parallel system to manage the resources. Now, you might be asking, how do we know that the local governments will spend this money on true climate adaptation? So in order to qualify for LOCAL expenditure and the LOCAL top-up performance-based climate resilient grants, you need to plug in to your national system, the LOCAL menu. And this is all about a vulnerability assessment, calculating the climate risks, and that may have been done by another third party or it may already exist. And then a menu of responses to that vulnerability, which can be measured in how effective they are at responding to that vulnerability. And then a menu of investments that address that response. And you work through this system using your own national and local institutions, and then you qualify for these grants. And the system is designed and built by each participating country. So it looks a little bit different in each country that, that manages it, but it's a totally nationally owned system. If the local government is not actually spending the extra resources on climate change, if it's buying an additional car for the mayor, then there are ways that the local government drops out of the system as a kind of punishment and can only come back in once that has been corrected. So that actually creates a kind of peer pressure to maintain it. Now, where does this money come from? Well, if central governments are wise, they can reorganize their climate finance that they have and direct it through the fiscal transfer system to local governments. And some countries have already done that. Because they see it's actually more effective to spend it this way rather than through the Ministry of Roads, through the local government system. However, Locale also supports countries in applying to the Green Climate Fund for direct access to the Green Climate Fund and other sources of climate finance to enable these funds to travel from global climate finance through the ministries of finance at national level down to local governments. To date, there are 22 countries that are engaged in the Locale mechanism. Some are at phase three, where it is now part of the national system, Cambodia being one example. Others are at phase two, where it's being scaled up, and others are at phase one, where it's just starting. But Locale is governed and controlled by the countries that join it. The 22 countries make up the board of Locale. And there are three co-chairs to this board. One is the head of the least developed country group at UNFCCC, which is currently Bhutan in that position. The second is the head of the least developed country group at the United Nations, and that is currently Malawi. And the third is myself, representing the United Nations Capital Development Fund that hosts the mechanism, which is also supported by Sweden and the European Union, amongst others. But the WRI and IIED are key partners, and Locale subscribes to the locally led adaptation principles, and through its member states is aiming to be part of the whole LDC 2050 initiative, and really of the vehicle to drive resources to where they matter at the local level and make sure that those local governments are truly accountable to the communities. And this is a very effective way of getting the money down there. I'm very happy to take questions later on, but I thought it would be useful just to spend the first 10 minutes to introduce you to what the mechanism is designed to do. Thank you so much indeed, Louise.
Thank you, David. And yeah, thank you for explaining the mechanism. It is an incredibly inspiring example of how to actually get local climate finance down to the local level. And we've now heard from David and Teddy about two examples, one which is an international mechanism and one which is an in-country mechanism in Rwanda. I see this is also being discussed in the chat. These two examples are actually not representative of the majority of climate finance. The majority of climate finance, as Saleem mentioned in the in his introduction, is not applying these principles of locally led adaptation. And I wanted to just turn to you again, Saleem, to reflect on why that is, and what do you think it will take to make these kind of approaches the norm rather than the exception?
It's a very good question, Louise. So I'll share an experience as an example, which I have had for some time now with the Green Climate Fund. As you know, the Green Climate Fund, which has been referred to already, is one of the big climate funds that was created a few years ago. It's been given billions of dollars to disburse. One of the good things that it did very early on is the board of the Green Climate Fund adopted a decision to allocate 50% of their funds to adaptation and 50% to mitigation. Good thing. They also adopted a resolution that the 50% on adaptation should be prioritized for the least developed countries and the most vulnerable countries, small island states, et cetera. good thing. However, in practice, they have not delivered, because what they did was they created a system. Firstly, they were doing both mitigation and adaptation funding. And in my view, these are apples and oranges that don't mix. Mitigation funding, let us say for renewable energy, generates a source of income that can repay the money that is given. And so they can give loans and they get repaid in their loans. And they love to do that. They love to give loans that they get their money back from. And so mitigation is easy. They did it. They spent lots and lots of money on mitigation. Adaptation doesn't pay back. Adaptation, particularly for poor people, they're not going to generate an income that's going to pay it back. It has to be a grant. And the Green Climate Fund is called the Green Climate Fund, not the Green Climate Bank. But they were all bankers. They recruited bankers who think about, you know, my job is to lend money and get it back. That's not what they were supposed to do for adaptation. And they didn't understand adaptation. It took them years to understand that they didn't understand adaptation. And they only recently decided that, yeah, we didn't understand it. We need to get it right. They've recruited some people now that are trying to get it right. They have not succeeded very well yet, in my view. I'm very glad to see that Teddy managed to get some funding from them. But I'm telling you, it's like extracting teeth, getting funding for adaptation out of the GCF. You know, the number of hurdles that they put in your place. And in fact, even in the last board meeting, even as recently a few weeks ago, two projects on adaptation from vulnerable countries were not given any funding. They were rejected by the experts, so-called experts, I call them now, who, you know, said these are not real adaptation projects and therefore they should not be eligible for funding. So I'm really describing a very, very hardwired paradigm of the way money is given in the whole world. It is lent, it's given for loans. Even when it's given for grant, there are so many hurdles put in place in order for it to be disbursed that the people on the ground, the most vulnerable, who don't really have the resources to do that, just simply cannot apply. And they, even though in principle, the board of the GCF said half of the money will go to adaptation, they still haven't been able to achieve that. You know, what they do is they fudge the figures. So they, if you look at the GCF funding, they'll show one third has gone for mitigation projects. One third has gone for adaptation projects. And then one third, they created this mitigation and adaptation co-benefit projects, which if you look at them, don't have much adaptation in them, I'm afraid. Okay, so they claim that they are achieving 50% when in my view, they're not. And so there's still a long way to go, even though they accept it. You know, the people, we know them, they're good people. I have nothing against them. But the way that the system has been set up, it is inimical. It is against the most vulnerable. It is not done to make it easy for the most vulnerable. It is done to make it more difficult for the most vulnerable. And that's a system flaw. That is just absolutely the wrong design. It's a design flaw. We can't overcome it by just some good intentions. And so, you know, we have to do better. We have to do things differently. And those who are doing things wrong have to accept that they're doing it wrong. If they don't accept that they've got it wrong, they'll never change. I hope that's useful. I don't know how much I answered your question, Louise.
It paints a very dismal picture of the climate finance world, Saleem. David, please.
Well, if I just may come in here, Louise, I really could not agree more with Saleem, and I'd just like to add a couple of points to what he's saying, really. It is a dismal picture. Let's be quite frank about this. You know, I think we need to look at this historically. We need to look at this as globally, as a planet, and as, you know, human beings on this planet. We have always adapted to climate change. We've always adapted to the climate throughout our history. The clothes we wear, the food we eat is all different depending on the climate. Now, that is not about finance. I could not agree more with Saleem. It's about the way we spend our resources, what we do with our time and our money. It's not about finance repaying banks, bankable projects. It's just about the way we live. So we need to understand that adaptation is about changing the way we live, the way we build things, the way we do things. It's not about repaying money to somebody. This is a key mistake that is being made. People have all, a few years ago, I attended a conference in Korea, which was all about the Holy Grail, trying to find, you know, the private sector kind of bankable project route to climate adaptation. And my comment was, well, the Holy Grail, I mean, it's a mythical thing and nobody knows if you ever find it. And if we spend all our life trying to find a way for climate adaptation to be funded through bankable projects, we will fail. It's actually about changing the way we do things. It's not about setting up individual projects, unlike mitigation, which is carbon related and can be converted. So I could not agree more with Saleemul in that. And it is a bleak project. It is a bleak perspective because we have not yet really understood that. And then the two other quick points I wanted to make is in response to the comments in the chat box, it's also about scale. So yes, it's true that local governments are not always completely accountable, but then central governments are also not always completely accountable. It's true that there has to be good connections with NGOs. Even NGOs themselves are not always accountable. But if you want to achieve this kind of scale, we have to start doing things differently. I mean, there is that saying, if you carry on doing the same thing, you'll get the same results. And if we want to adapt to a rapidly changing climate, we need to, at scale, change the way our roads are maintained, at scale, change the way our bridges are built, at scale, change the way our land is managed, change the way our water systems are managed, irrigation, drainage, storage, change the way our agricultural extension works. And that can only be done by significant resources at the local level to those institutions that are mandated to do that work. The ministries of environment are regulatory bodies. They are not doers, they are regulators. You have to get the money in the hand of the doers, and these are local institutions, both state and non-state, both NGOs and local governments. Unless you actually get that money down there with the methodologies to make sure it's usefully properly implemented, we will not achieve the scale at the speed required. And time really is running out. We were saying time was running out 10 years ago. Now it really is running out. I mean, Saleemul was quite right. Just open the newspapers and look at what's happening. It's running out. And it is a bleak picture, Louise. Sorry for the audience, but we have to change what we're doing because it's too late to mitigate completely. It's now about adaptation. It's now going to be about adaptation. Whatever we do, it's going to be about adaptation now. Thank you.
Saleem, I see you have your hand raised. Do you want to respond to that?
Yes, please, if I can. Just build on what David just said. I apologize in advance for mentioning my own country. And it's not perfect by any means, but I can tell you that my country, Bangladesh, where I'm speaking from, has 165 million people who 10 years ago realized that we are one of the most vulnerable to the impacts of climate change. And we have not been sitting idle. We have been figuring out what we need to do. We have developed our own national climate change strategy and action plan. We have put our own money, not donor money, our own money into building a climate change trust fund. The finance minister for the last 10 years has put in $100 million of our money, taxpayer money, into that fund, and we have funded hundreds of adaptation projects all across the country from small scale to big scale. And in the last few years, the government has now started mainstreaming climate change allocations in the government budget itself. And in the current budget, 8% of the national budget is spread over 25 ministries of the government to tackle climate change. That is the biggest proportion of any country in the world that is putting its money where its mouth is in tackling climate change. And we are going up a learning curve very, very fast across the country. Now, let me give you a subset of that information and activity, which is at the local level, all right? Locally led adaptation is one of our key, I would say, things that we all buy into. A lot of NGOs doing it, a lot of local government doing it. We have the local project that David is in charge of. They're working here through UNDP with the local government ministry. There are hundreds, if not thousands, of examples of things happening in Bangladesh. And I really do think that Bangladesh is way ahead of any other country in terms of taking this issue seriously, investing in it ourselves with our own money and our own intellect and our own researchers and our own local people. And we are going up a learning curve faster than any other country in the world. And we are very, very happy to share that knowledge with other countries. And I just sent a note to Teddy inviting her to give us a talk, because we'd love to learn about her fund and see how we might be able to develop similar kinds of funds here. And the final point I'll make, having worked on adaptation to climate change for now well over two decades, the number one successful modality of knowledge sharing is peer-to-peer knowledge sharing. It isn't writing or reading scientific articles. It isn't preparing or learning about climate models. It's about doing and learning from doing. And the doers are, as I said, they're on the ground. They're doing things in Rwanda. They're doing things in Bangladesh. Rwanda and Bangladesh is different. But at the same time, there are similarities. And if we talk to each other, we'll find out there are quite a few similarities in terms of things that we are doing that we can learn from each other and share with each other. So peer to peer, south to south, and even south to north, not north to south, but south to north, is an option that we should be thinking of. In fact, I'm right now in the process of talking to friends in Germany, how Bangladesh can teach Germany how to tackle climate change, because those number of deaths that happened in Germany would not have happened in Bangladesh. We have a very good warning system. We would have a lot of damage. We still have a lot of floods that cause a lot of damage, but we don't have deaths on that scale because people get warnings and they evacuate in time. And we have a very, very good warning and evacuation system that the Germans didn't have in place. And so, you know, this knowledge on adaptation is one of those kinds of knowledge that go the opposite direction of what we used to think of as transfer of knowledge and technology, which was always from developed to developing or north to south. Adaptation is the other way around.
Thank you, Saleem. I think that you put that very eloquently, and I completely agree with you. I want to turn to Teddy. Rwanda, of course, is also a country that's shown immense leadership on climate change issues. Where do you see the Green Fund going in future, you know, building on the successes that you've had to date? What is the outlook and what is the plan for the future?
Thank you, Louise. So I think before I answer your question, I want to again highlight our very ambitious NDC targets that Rwanda just committed. So we've committed to reduce carbon emissions by 38% by the year 2030. And this has been estimated to $11 billion. So I like to start from that statement because, again, we're talking about access to climate finance, and this is such a big chunk of money. So the direction we're taking as a country and specifically at the Rwanda Green Fund is we want to also tap into private investments, but also looking at how do we ensure, like thinking about sustainability, we cannot just depend on grant funding. So it's really going to be important that we also think about adopting a blended approach, way of mobilizing and also bringing in the finance. And I think this also kind of answers the discussion we're having. And I saw it in the chat box, someone asked, how do we ensure that the jobs created are actually sustained? You know, how do we ensure that these jobs are sustained beyond the project lifetime or beyond this external finance? Again, that's where we want to think, to really look at ways in which we can support the vulnerable, but not just from a grant and aid support, but more like how do we make sure that these local communities are working together to form cooperatives which can then be supported. But where they also, you know, where there's a sort of profit making, and that way they're able to sustain. So just to give an example, there's a project we're implementing in one of our districts, and we're looking at establishing a community adaptation fund. And this is, again, we believe these are the sort of innovative ways that are going to be addressing adaptation, because we can't just think about the Green Climate Fund or, you know, these multilaterals. I think it's high time that we also think of of homegrown solutions, you know, whereby local communities can, you know, through microfinance or where they can put themselves together to form a small, like a fund, adaptation fund, but at the community level. For me, that's the thing. I think going forward, we want to diversify our sources of funding. But also I like what Saleem said, also looking at, you know, even in Rwanda, like locally, domestically, how do we ensure that we're also generating significant amounts of domestic revenues that can be channeled to addressing climate change, and not just thinking about external, because we all know, we've all talked about the processes, how strict they are. So I like the idea of, you know, working with the Ministry of Finance to look into ways in which they can even, some of the budget supports, funding that they give to sectors, it's very possible that some of that funding could be allocated to addressing climate change. So maybe I've said a whole lot, but I think it's important that countries at the national planning level, it's important that countries take this serious. They have to have the right strategies in place, and then the mechanisms, funding mechanisms. And otherwise, if there are no funding mechanisms, there's no way the funding is going to flow. But also thinking of ways, I like to use the example of the Rwanda Green Fund. Our mandate is just to channel, it's just to mobilize the funding. But when it comes to discussing, we don't implement. So we put calls for proposals, and I think this is something that's nice, because we're able to generate traction from, you know, whether it's a public sector institution, whether it's private sector with NGOs. So we are not the ones designing the projects. No. We mobilize the funding. We just have to make sure that we have a criteria, but we're ensuring that the projects are being implemented and designed in consultations with the stakeholders and the beneficiaries. So I think this is one way of ensuring that that the funding goes where it's supposed to go, but also we ensure that the vulnerable people are benefit from this. Thank you.
Thank you, Teddy. It's a model that's very empowering to local beneficiaries and actors on the ground. David, you've got your hand raised. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Well, thank you. I'd like to respond to the question in the chat about examples of South-North collaboration, if you like, or learning, and also give a very practical kind of case study. And unfortunately, there are not enough examples. One very practical case study is that there was some flooding about a year or two ago in the UK, quite significant flooding. And this would not have happened if the way that the development land had been built had taken into account climate adaptation. So you have a river, you have a floodplain, and you're supposed, the floodplain is called a floodplain because it's there for when the river floods. Now, of course, thinking they knew everything, they tried to rechannel the river and build houses on that floodplain area. And then, of course, the river burst its banks and a lot of property was damaged, and the houses were lost. And this is exactly the kind of thing where in some countries, it would not be possible. Floodplains are respected, and people know how to design the development of an area in accordance with and in partnership with the environment, if you like, rather than trying to dominate that environment. Now, the insurance industry is interestingly taking the lead on this, because for them, they can start to factor in features like this. And so it would be nowadays a little bit more difficult or even impossible in some parts of the US where I am right now to get projects insured if they are on those kind of floodplains. And the lessons are filtering through. And it is very interesting, as Saleemul says, actually the lessons of how to do this properly are often in the global South. And the mechanisms for that learning are not properly institutionalized yet, but it is starting to happen. And I think it's a very interesting development and a very welcome one. Thank you.
Thank you very much, David. I noted there's a comment here in the chat from Mohammed Asuyuti from the Adaptation Fund who mentions that the Adaptation Fund has adopted the principles of locally led adaptation. And you know, in my experience, and I'd be interested to know if you feel the same, Saleem, the Adaptation Fund is the global fund that I, from what I've seen, is doing the most to truly promote locally led adaptation and to, you know, put the developing country actors in the driver's seat. And you mentioned, Saleem, in your intervention that there's a need to separate mitigation and adaptation. I agree with that. And I think that part of the reason the Adaptation Fund has been more successful than the GCF in you know, actually realizing direct access is because it's focused exclusively on adaptation. But I just wanted to ask if you could also reflect a bit on how we could scale these approaches up. You've mentioned that, you know, that they are still the minority and that the sort of global finance architecture is unfortunately still quite a dismal picture. And I think part of the reason for that is because these international institutions and international donors actually don't always have the incentive to promote locally led adaptation. You know, the incentives sometimes are pushing in the opposite direction. And in the face of these kind of political economy issues, how do we address that and actually get local actors, you know, in the driver's seat? And, you know, make sure that the kind of examples like we've seen from Rwanda and we've seen from the Locale program, you know, more widespread.
Sure. So a couple of thoughts to share with you. I certainly myself, having been very closely associated with the creation of the Adaptation Fund and the running of the Adaptation Fund for many years, as an observer, a very close observer, by the way, would say that they have done a relatively better job than others. And I certainly would say that. And in fact, one of my advocacies, which has never worked, has been for the Green Climate Fund to give half their money to the Adaptation Fund. You know, they said we'd do 50-50, 50% adaptation. We don't know anything about adaptation. The Adaptation Fund does. So let's give them the money and let them do it. That would have actually done a lot better over the last 10 years, but instead of the GCF trying to figure out, you know, that they were the experts on adaptation and they had to define what was adaptation and who gets the money. And so they wasted a lot of time, in my mind, criminally wasted time and money, all right? So this was not well spent money at all from the donor's perspective who gave them the money. So I would still argue that the GCF, I know that they're talking to the Adaptation Fund, should just give Adaptation Fund the authority to use their GCF money, which is much, much bigger than the money that Adaptation Fund has, to deliver the adaptation portfolio that they have never been able to do. But however, let me also address some of the inbuilt systemic issues that even a good fund like the Adaptation Fund has, which is that doing things at a local level with the granularity that it requires is time intensive and it's human resource intensive. You have to get involved. You have to take the time to get involved. I'm sure David's having the same experience in, in the local, it's not easy. It doesn't happen easily. And a short-term project where you have to deliver something, it's easier to give the money to some big organization, a big NGO, or a big, you know, a government agency and say, okay, you do it now, and then tell us that you spent the money and we'll come and see whether we can, you know, we'll certify that it was well spent. I've been asking the Adaptation Fund to share with me information on local adaptation support that they've given. They've had a very hard time doing that because they don't monitor it to that level. They give money to X, it's a big agency in the government, and they ask X to tell them, what did you do with the money? They don't know where it went. Okay, and X gives them an answer and they say, okay, that's the answer. So now I've been arguing with them that they need to track it. They need to see where it's going. Number one, tracking, absolutely zero. I mentioned earlier that only 2% was able to be tracked to the local level because nobody tracks. Not a single donor tracks where the money is going. They track it to who they gave it to, and then after that, they don't care where it went. The who they gave it to is the one that's in charge. The second issue that is, again, an inbuilt systemic problem is that local, whether they're local government, like in the local case, or even local groups, require small amounts of money. And managing small amounts of money is not an easy task. You know, if you have a 100 million, giving out in $2,000 chunks, it requires a huge investment. That's why Teddy's Rwanda fund is so good, because she can take that responsibility of giving it at the very local level in small amounts. All right. And so one of the design flaws they had was not allowing these kinds of vehicles to be funded who would then take the responsibility for giving it at small amounts, at small level, with technical assistance at a very local level to help these communities. The big funds are simply not geared to do that, and they need to give their money away. And I'll give you an example of this, where in the GCF, where they now started something called Enhanced Direct Access, they are putting together 200 million for 20 projects for this kind of fund. So an intermediary can come and take 10 million and then disperse it in small amounts to local level. But it's now 10 years since they started this and they haven't been able to do it. You know, I don't know if they'll even succeed. I mean, the intention is good, but they don't have a good track record of delivery, I'm afraid. I'll stop there.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. And I mean, there's an example of one of the GCF's enhanced direct access projects. I think one of only two that actually happened is in Namibia. But that project included quite a significant component of capacity building and training and enhancing local governance, which got cut out by the GCF's ITAP and board. So it actually became a much less impactful project than it should have been. So I would agree that that's a little bit unfortunate.
David wants to come, yeah.
Yeah. Well, I just wanted to add to some of these architectural features that have just been mentioned. I think one as well is the projectization of adaptation. I think as Saleem has mentioned, you know, it can't be done through projects because the amount of money for these locally led adaptation requirements, even in large cities, you know, where you're going down to individual neighborhoods, is a small amount of money. And so you have to have a way of aggregating it and creating a mechanism for this rather than a project. But the GCF and even the Adaptation Fund has been set up on a project by project basis. And projects also tend to be managed by the World Bank or UNDP or whoever it is. And they require project advisors, project managers, project vehicles. So a project has an overhead, which is expensive with all the project management operations. A project is also too short term, and it's not a systemic behavioral change. It's a one-off. And so you cannot projectize adaptation. And that's why we need these mechanisms like the ones that have been described. And Locale aims to be such a mechanism where you say, okay, let's find a new way for local governments to work, or a new way for community-based organizations to work. And let's find a channel of finance to these people that respects this new way and that has built-in checks and balances, but that is managed locally. And that's the idea. of, you know, if a local government does not use the funds correctly, then it just falls out of the system. If a union parish is using it, it falls out and comes back a few years later. So you can keep on moving. You don't have to have like a project with a project set up to do it, because we haven't historically adapted through projects. We've adapted through ways of living, a continual. It's, adaptation is continual. So I think that is one of the architectural features, this projectization rather than looking at mechanisms and systems. A second one, which was alluded to really, is this issue of accreditation and the access to these entities, the adaptation funds, the Green Climate Fund. So, you know, I mean, for good reasons as well, you not anybody can access them. You have to be accredited and there's an accreditation process. And then, you know, if you're a big bank or a central government ministry or a large international organization, you're already accredited and you can apply and go through a process. So that itself is, of course, important for governance features, but it's also an institutional blockage in some senses. And I think the type of entity that has been accredited is the type of entity that likes to work with projects. One of the problems with the direct access is it took such a long time to get moving, so that in order to get things started first, you had the project-based institutions becoming accredited and then setting up projects to manage this money. So you have the accreditation question of how that is managed and governed, and you have the projectization versus the mechanisms. And then finally, I think I would agree that it's about large amounts of money being spent in small batches rather than through huge schemes. And so it's about the aggregation and the standards of aggregation and the way in which those mechanisms can be governed. And that's what we're trying to deal with locale, and there are other examples as well. But it's we need to get that right. I think we probably need a bit of a rethink of the way that we're going to finance adaptation. And perhaps this South-North learning will help, because as richer countries also need to look at the same thing. They're also starting to wake up. There needs to be some of these mechanisms we're talking about. It's not about only for the South. They need to find ways of doing it. You know, I was once talking to, at one of the COP conferences, I was talking to a county mayor from one of the counties in Colorado, in the United States. And he was saying, gee, I wish we had something like locale in the US. My town is burning up and there's nothing I can do. And so it's a global issue. And I think the more we can raise it to that level through this South-North learning and get away from some of the, if you excuse my language, some of the arrogance of some of the richer countries thinking that they know it all, then I think we will make progress. But thank you very much, Louise. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much, David. I absolutely agree with that. We have a question here in the chat which talks about the sort of linkages between adaptation and peace and security and conflict. And I wanted to put that question to Teddy, because Rwanda, of course, is a country that is recovering from the genocide in 1994, and that has placed a lot of focus on peace building and, you know, integrating that the whole peace building process into systems of governance. And I just wondered if you would like to reflect on the linkages between building resilience and promoting peace in the Rwandan context.
Thank you, Louise. It's not an easy question, but I think just to maybe speak on from a Rwandan context, I think most of you know, so Rwanda, we went through a genocide in 1994, and but I believe that Rwanda has done tremendous job at recovering from this, and what has been at the core of our development is unity and reconciliation. So before I even talk about climate change, linking climate change and peace, I think it's just very important that development is key. So, and addressing poverty, Because I think the what happens usually in communities when there's poverty and vulnerability, then this obviously, it's very easy to have, you know, it's very easy to have, to lose that peace and so, so I think one, it has to be in the principles. So this, especially at the local government, we have a very good governance system whereby also everything is decentralized at the local government. So just to give you an example, even the projects that we implement, so our projects in, whether it's forestry restoration projects or watershed management projects, we ensure that the government, the local government is involved, of course, with the local communities, and our projects, they basically benefit all. So I think the most important thing is that nobody is left behind, because again, when we're talking about climate change affects everybody. Climate change affects the whole world. So I think climate change can actually be, I would say it, in a sense, it's actually a factor that brings unity, because people usually unite when they have a common problem. So I think the fact that climate change impacts are real, especially for the local communities, because of their livelihoods. You know, most of these people are subsistence farmers, and others are involved in restoration projects. So if everybody is hit and equally hit, then they actually see this as a problem they have to tackle together. So again, it wasn't an easy one, but I've never actually thought about this before, but it's a very good point. I believe that we can use the challenges that of climate change to actually unite people so they can come together and come up with solutions to combat it. Thank you.
Thank you, Teddy. I think that was a very inspiring answer to a rather tricky question. We have about 3 minutes left of this discussion, and I'd like to end by asking each of the panelists just very briefly to give us a sense of what gives you hope for the future of adaptation finance and locally led adaptation, or are you hopeful? And if so, what gives you hope? I think I'll start with David and then go to Teddy and then Saleem.
Mixed hopeful and unhopeful. It depends on what mood I'm in. I'm not convinced we're going to make it, but I think what would give me hope is two things. I mean, one is that things like, you know, the insurance industry and big money waking up to the importance of this, that, you know, that gives me a little bit of hope that and the second thing that gives me hope, I think, is the youth. Young people are really realizing that, you know, this is their future we're talking about here. And then people not even that young, I'm talking about, you know, people up to 30, 40 years old thinking, well, wait a minute, this is actually going to happen in my lifetime. And that is also a huge reason for hope. So I think those are the two things that give me hope. But we're not out of the woods yet by any means. Thank you.
Thank you, David. I certainly think you are hopeful, because if you weren't, you wouldn't be putting in the time and effort that you do. Teddy, what gives you hope?
Thank you, Louise. I think for me, just going through what we've all been through with COVID, with the COVID pandemic, I have to say that although it's obviously been a terrible, we are still in these bad times, but I think there's hope. Looking at how, you know, especially from the donors and the developed countries, and everybody's talking about green recovery. So I think COVID has taught us a lot. I think going through this pandemic and seeing how the impact has been on economies, and I think people are actually now starting to really realize that, okay, this is one shock, but climate change also poses significant risks and threats. So I think my hope, why I'm hopeful, is that I think it's been an eye opening, and people are now taking climate change more seriously. And as we recover, we're all talking about recovering better and greener. So I can only be hopeful that this will be sustained. Thank you. And obviously, you know, it also presents opportunities to tap into more climate finance. And so I think people are also going to think of new ways of accessing this finance. Thank you.
Thank you, Teddy. Saleem, what gives you hope?
Well, I think, you know, in order to remain in this business, one has to be an eternal optimist in the face of reality. So as David said, you know, if we were realists, then we'd become cynics because things are not good. And so, you know, we are by nature optimists. But what gives me hope, and I'll build on Teddy's emphasis on youth. You know, I'm a teacher, I teach in a university. My students are the best and the brightest, and they are willing to do stuff. They don't need money. They need guidance, and they are willing to go and they put their energy into doing things. And this is true for young people all over the world. And to me, that is the future, and that's the investment that we need to be thinking about. And that's what I am doing in my university, and also in Bangladesh. We have more than 100 universities in Bangladesh. We have formed a platform called Gobeshana, which is a Bangla word for research. More than 50 universities have joined that. We are now building the next generation of our country's leaders. They are all going to university today. In 10 years' time, they're going to be the leaders of the country in politics, in business, in the bureaucracy, in all kinds of fields. We are going to make them into a locally led adaptation champions cohort of citizens and make Bangladesh a climate resilient and a climate prosperous country. We will overcome climate change. Bangladesh has a long history of overcoming odds. You know, we have been written off by the likes of Henry Kissinger a long time ago as a basket case, and we have proven him wrong. We can prove climate change wrong as well. So I have great hope and faith in that, and young people around the world, not just in Bangladesh, young people everywhere.
Thank you so much for those inspiring words, Saleem. Thank you to my eminent panel, David Jackson, Teddy Mugabo, and Saleemul. I don't think I can add anything more to what you said. It was very inspiring. Thank you to the audience for joining us for this session. I'm sorry we didn't manage to answer all of the questions, but I think we've managed to answer many of them. We will keep a record of the questions, and maybe there'll be an opportunity to get back to you on some of them. I'd also like to thank my colleagues, Karina and Francesca, who've been helping us in the background of this webinar. And I wish all of you a good rest of your afternoon, evening, or morning. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much,
Louise.
Thank you very much, Louise. Thank you. Good to see everybody as well. Bye-bye. Take care. Indeed.